Thank you, Carolyn. Thank you all for being here right now. And first and foremost, right at the top, I do want to extend my thoughts to the Sherman family. I think when all is said and done, I hope that we don't lose fact that this investigation is because we've lost two individuals, parents, grandparents, brothers and sisters, and the loss of life is something that we do take seriously. And I also want to make it clear that we all have the same objective. I had the opportunity of listening to Mr. Greenspan in his presentation today. We all have the same objective. At the end of the day, we want to bring those people responsible for this investigation before the judicial system. And that is something that we will make every effort to, and we'll continue to make every effort to move towards that. And I also want to clarify that the Toronto Police Service never reached a premature conclusion with this investigation. This investigation has been done to a very high level of professionalism and high level of expertise. I know Detective Sergeant Susan Gomes, and she has been a homicide investigator for quite some time, very credible in the courtroom, has presented herself well in every case that I have seen her involved in. And when we take this investigation, I can tell you right from the start, one of the first things that was done as a precautionary, as it started out as a divisional investigation, homicide was on scene right away, watching, monitoring, making sure everything was in fact done. Number two, a forensic pathologist was also brought on scene, an extra layer of level of expertise to help navigate with understanding the crime scene, understanding the gravity of where this investigation needs to go. And so facting those two, you can see that there's a lot of work and effort right at the forefront. When we talk about the officers involved in the case, when we have over 50 officers involved in the case, when we talk about over 39 judicial authorizations that have been presented, over 4,000 pages of typed documents with this investigation, the fact that the house was searched for over 6 weeks forensically and very thoroughly, the fact that well over 200 witnesses have been interviewed, the fact that the neighborhood was canvassed, over 4 terabytes, over 2,000 hours of video has been retrieved, and the fact that this is still an ongoing investigation leads me to conclude that the investigation was not taken lightly and still is not taken lightly. When we talk about the fact that the investigators have worked hand in hand with the Ministry of the Attorney General's office, worked hand in hand with the Center of Forensic Sciences, these are two fields that are knowledgeable, skilled when it comes to these types of investigations. And the fact that there was tremendous involvement right from the start, as well as several case conferences held over and over to make sure that this investigation was looked at with the highest regard. So I just want to say that all of those things are and have been presented with respect to this investigation. We have created important partnerships, as I've just described to you, and along the way, we've received reassurance from important legal minds. I want to take you to Justice Pringle, who has a full understanding of the investigation when she read the information to obtain, and her conclusion speaks to the thoroughness of the investigation. And so we put all of these things together, and we conclude that the investigation was done well and continues to be done well. But I do want to say it's not over yet. I do want to say that we are continuing to work very hard to reach the conclusion that we feel we can reach with the help of the public. I don't want to get into specifics of all of the evidentiary pieces that were spoken about, but I will say that the evidence will take us where we need to go, and we'll continue to work and try our best to resolve this investigation to reach a successful conclusion. And we encourage the lawyers that we have right now to continue the discussions regarding the information and protocol for exhibits sharing so that we can have a proper and robust protocol that will help us in furthering this. And we also support the family's decision to put up the reward. Anything that helps lead to a successful conclusion, I think, is a good thing. We know that historically that rewards don't necessarily help when it comes to concluding cases, but this is an opportunity that may offer great assistance. It certainly will put the investigation back in light again, and hopefully there are people that are out there that have an understanding or have information that can help further this investigation. So, as always, there is that public appeal, so that if anyone has any information that hasn't provided that information yet, to please contact the Homicide Squad at 808-7400 and help us solve this investigation. And I will take any questions if anyone has any right now.
Chief, we heard from the family's lawyer proposing a public-private partnership, offering Toronto Police private resources. Is that something that you're open to?
Well, you know, that point was something that was brought up, and examples have that were also brought up when we talk about forensic accountants and specialized entities within the private sector that help us solve particular crimes. When I talk about the modernization plan and talking about creating stronger partnerships to enhance community safety, those are things that are considered. But I will tell you, it has to withstand the integrity of the court of law. It has to withstand the continuity piece, and it also has to go through that bias lens. What is that private sector? What is the vested interest in that private sector? Who is paying that private sector? Does it have any influence or effect on that particular investigation? So these are things that have to be scrutinized and have to be weighed out, because at the end of the day, for a conclusion to any type of investigation, it has to be brought before the court of law. It has to withstand all of those tests in order to be successful. And that's our end game. It has to be done successfully to withstand the scrutiny that will be brought before any courts.
You don't think that the team assembled or suggested by the Sherman family and their lawyer would meet that test then?
I didn't say that. The question was asked and I answered that question. Yes.
What kind of communication have you had with the private investigator, and have you received the information or the evidence, as they're calling it, that they have discussed?
In its totality, no, but I can say that there was a face-to-face in May of this year, and the request was to receive the evidence that was seized so that it can be put into the investigation, and the lead investigator, who has the best knowledge of this case, has the opportunity to reach that conclusion that we're all trying to reach. Due to the... Well, there are specifics that need to be also added on. I won't get into that because it does lead towards evidentiary pieces, which I don't want to disclose. Some things were disclosed today that, you know, I have to be cognizant that the suspects or suspects, no doubt, are watching this right now. I know that for a fact. And so I want to be careful to not present any evidence to help that particular person or individuals that are responsible. And so I'm not trying to not answer the question, but I'm cognizant of what the big picture is. And so there are times when I won't be able to give a fulsome answer to certain questions that are going to be asked.
Do you hear then that them speaking out about some of the specifics of the things that they brought forward could then jeopardize the case?
I will get back to what the initial thought was. And I do believe that we all have the same goals. The Sherman family are frustrated and concerned. And I do believe that Mr. Greenspan has the same objective that we have, which is to reach a conclusion. We would love to do that. There are steps in order to get there. The Toronto Police Service will lead, continues to lead all investigations, especially when they are serious ones, such as homicides. And what that map looks like to get to that finish line, we will figure out as the lawyers have their conversations.
Chief, harsh criticism for Toronto Police. We heard from the family's lawyer, things like the door locks not being investigated, fingerprints and DNA from the scene. That should have been done right away. How do you respond to that?
Well, you know, I just want to make a comment when Justice Pringle, there are very few people that have the entire investigation. And Mr. Greenspan does not have the entire investigation. Justice Pringle has had a look at the most recent information to obtain. My lead investigators have the full understanding of the investigation. CFS has a lot of the information, and the Ministry of the Attorney General. And Justice Pringle said a comment which I think leads to today, where she said, read out of context and in isolation, bits and pieces of information have real potential to be misleading. And so because you don't have all of that information, homicide investigations are dynamic, they're fluid in nature, and the best person to make the decisions in real time are the lead investigators, the highly trained lead investigators. And I will tell you that the members of the Toronto Police Service do the most homicides in Canada. They are challenged and scrutinized more so than any others, and rightfully so, and they accept that challenge. But I will tell you, they have a very high conviction rate, and it is because of their professionalism. It's because they understand law, they understand how to gather the evidence, present it properly, so we have the successful outcome. So if you have an opinion on it, you're entitled to that opinion. We don't deal with opinions, we deal with facts. That's what we bring before the courts, and we have a very strong, successful rate in doing just that.
So Chief, to your point though, if you believe that investigators only have the private investigators only have a small piece of the puzzle, why not commit to working together to bring those pieces of the puzzle together.
And I don't want to oversimplify that. You know, Mr. Greenspan brought up the good point about integrity and about continuity. All of those factors have to come into play. You don't just walk over and go, here you go, and walk out. But as a police agency, knowing that we have to bring things before court, we have to ask the questions. How did you gather that information? Are you accredited with respect to gathering that information? Are your accreditations up to date and up to speed? What methodology did you use? Why did you use that methodology? Who was present at the time? Was it videoed? Were there comprehensive notes that were taken? All of these things need to come into play in order to properly do that. So it's not just that simple. There are a lot of pieces to it. And what's more important is I think that we're all moving towards that. And I'm not trying to create a divide here. I think that this is an opportunity, that we do have that opportunity to move forward, to reach that successful outcome. I think that would be something that we'd like to have at the end of the day. But those things have to be considered when it comes to how things happen. It's not that simple.
Wouldn't having a formalized partnership help you answer some of those questions to make sure that you basically have a bunch of extra hands helping, you're able then to check that they're using, you know, methods that will stand up
I'm
to
sorry,
the test in court?
And I got to tell you, I answered that question if you heard me in the past 5 minutes. I really did.
Why haven't we heard from Toronto Police in the last 10 months? Why have there been such few updates?
It's not, the update is not important. What is important is the investigation is ongoing, the investigation is continuing, that the investigation is furthering. And when you read Justice Pringle's comments, she states just that. It's not me saying that. Highly trained officers of the court are saying that. And I get my briefings when I need them. I have all the faith in the investigators that work on these investigations. This investigation is not taken lightly. It never has been, it never will be. And as I stated before, there was no pre-conclusion that had any interference whatsoever with the actions that were taken, when they were taken, with respect to this particular case.
Chief, I'm sure you're aware of this, but the family has suggested that police suggested that this was a murder-suicide early on. Obviously something they did not agree with. They were very upset by that. But we heard very early on from detectives that they weren't looking for any suspects. There was no sign of forced entry and no concern for public safety. Why would you say that so early on?
And I'll touch on a couple of things, and I'll be very frank. At no point in time did the Toronto Police Service say that this was a murder-suicide. People took the ball and ran. We did not say that, and I'll be very clear on that. And the point that you're talking about, yes, early on in the investigation, officers spoke, and there's a backstory to the whole thing. What was said was that to alleviate the concerns of the neighborhood, and to further go on and say people in the area's mindset at ease. Those things were said in that statement. And it was because in that particular area, I'm not sure if you're aware, but there was an inordinate rash of break-and-enters in that area. Something like 160 break-and-areas in a very affluent area that had happened in a very short period of time. That neighborhood, that community was incredibly alarmed. Their concern was, are we going to be able to sleep tonight? Was this a break-and-enter gone wrong? Should we sleep? Should we go somewhere? What is going on? And so a town hall was had a week and a half before addressing those very concerns for that specific community. So when that officer was speaking in context of that geographical neighborhood, which is why he clearly said, I want to alleviate the concerns of the neighborhood. I want to put the neighborhood's mind at ease.
But you say there were no suspects.
And still, the official stance that we took was suspicious. It was a suspicious investigation right from the start. Any homicide investigation, when a determination of the investigation is made, is after the postmortem. It's after the postmortem. Any homicide case, when we say what it is after the postmortem. It's not said on scene. And so the lead investigator is the person responsible for that. The lead investigator worked hard with the Center of Forensic Science and with the Ministry of the Attorney General's office. But I can tell you, in less than 24 hours, it was a suspicious investigation. And due diligence was exercised. It did not in any way reflect on the mindset or the direction that was taken with this particular investigation.
Is there any part of this investigation that you think was mishandled?
What was that?
Is there any part of this investigation, this high-profile investigation, that you think, from your point of view, was mishandled?
Well, I can tell you personally, being involved in homicide investigations and running homicide investigations over and over again, I can take every single case that I've done, and there are things that I could have done differently. So the generic answer to that is any given time, yeah. Could you be a better person tomorrow? Sure. So it's the answer. Anyone at any time could do something different with respect to their investigations from any magnitude. But what I do want to get across is this is a homicide investigation. This is taken seriously. Highly trained officers who have to make decisions in a very fluid and dynamic environment in real time. And nobody, and I repeat, nobody has the ability of making the proper decisions than those people in those moments based on the three-dimensional components of what has to be understood, interpreted, analyzed, and then figuring out what the next step is to move the investigation further. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody.